Welcome back. So today, I made this little discovery. Somebody has implemented Flick Chess for Lee Chess, and they've shared their source code on GitHub. And I saw the video. I don't know if this Creative Commons copyrighted or not, so I don't know if I'm able to show it here, but feel free to go over to the Lee Chess feedback forum, search for this variant, and see what this enthusiast has come up with. He says, yeah, it might be a unique feature if there's interest out there and a willingness from the devs to maintain it. So, hey, I'm not guaranteeing that Lee Chess is going to maintain this, but it could be fun to play with it, right? Let's take that car and ride with it and see how far we get. Oh, hang on. Okay. What have I done here? Right. I have to commit my changes from last time. That's what I gotta do. Whoops. Modules and UI. Git diff dash dash cached shows me when I'm about to commit. Git commit. Use bash for PLR parallel. UI build. I don't know if I actually want to commit the other thing. Never mind. Let's back out some of my changes. Git diff. Oh, that wasn't included. So I want to include this build settings change. Git status shows me what I've changed. Git reset head on modules. Git diff cached now shows me when I'm about to commit. So there we go. Git commit changes to make to fix for my PC, my server. Git push. Oh wait, git status shows us where we're at. The branch name was, unfortunately, it's AI user hyphen new. That's okay. Git push dash F that. But we're going to push the AI user new branch. Hang on. Push the AI user new branch to the origin repository using our SSH key and so forth. Okay, so that's been pushed. Git status, actually git stash clear, because I don't remember what's in my stash, but I'm going to put into the stash my change that says don't automatically play AI versus AI matches. Git status. All right, git checkout master. Let's put us back. Whoa, that's no good. Oh my goodness. How am I ahead of origin slash master? Oh, right. Git push origin master. Origin is my copy of Lee Chess. Upstream is the official Lee Chess repository. And while we're in that vein, I'm going to be adding a repository here, which is this one. This N Holbert. So we're going to cop. I'm going to get the URL. Here it is. Copy that into clipboard. Git remote dash v to show these are the remotes. Git remote He had, oh, what was his name? N. Holbert. It's going to be that one. All right. So now what I've got to do, I want to first bring up my copy of Lee Chess to the latest and greatest copy. And then second, start a branch based on what N. Holbert here has done. Although he is 860 commits behind, so I want to accelerate my want to bring my Leela up to date with the latest everything, and then bring this as well as my branch up to date. Why don't we handle things one at a time though? Oh shoot, he calls this master. Okay, so how do I check out his master as something other than master? I need to figure out how to do things in Git. Git check out branch as name. Okay, you can have multiple, you can get checkout dash B, branch name of your choice, and then remote name slash branch name. So I can do that. So git fetch this master, git checkout B N Holbert, and then we want to say N Holbert master. Okay, git checkout master puts us back on track. So now what I'm going to try to do is bring everything up to date. And this is always a process that involves a little bit of friction, sometimes a lot of friction. We'll see how far we get. Because I'm not sure how far, like, his is 660 commits behind, or 860 commits behind. I'm sure my own repository was a different number other than 860. Mine's 244 behind. And since all these branches are sharing the same database, they all have to be synced to the same version for it to work. Otherwise, there's a pretty high risk of it not working. So, that said, I have to bring everything up to date, so I will. Git pull upstream master brings up my local copy to the upstream master copy. That's cool. Then we're going to check out my version, which is AI user hyphen new. Git rebase. So apply my changes on top of the master. Amazingly, there's zero conflicts. Or at least all the conflicts could be handled by a three-way merge. So that was auto-merged. So all my changes are now up to date. To sanity check that, I will use my install script to make sure that everything builds. I probably should have called my script build.sh rather than install.sh, or called it make.sh or something, but, you know, I'll welcome feedback on what to call said script. It goes, automatically executes most of the commands, which can be found at, where's the wiki? So you go to GitHub, ornicar/Leela, and then I think the wiki here indicates, just in terms of basic steps for getting set up, you need to install all these tools. So Git, the simple build tool, Node Package Manager, ZSH, the Z shell, MongoDB, the database, Nginx, the reverse proxy server, web server, Java 8, which not only is a compiler, but it's a runtime environment, and Clojure for compiling something to JavaScript. And then you see there's this big old process of all these things you gotta set up for it to work. Download the latest Eclipse Mars. Is Mars actually the latest? I don't remember. If you want to set up SSL, there's some ways to do that too. You could self-sign certificates and so forth. I actually tried to do that with Let's Encrypt and encountered some difficulties because my domain name is free, and doing self-signed certificates for free domain names is actually problematic from a security standpoint, and they don't really support it that well. So my instance of LeechS is insecure until such time I feel like paying for a non-free domain. And paying for a domain would allow them to better check my identity, and if there are any issues with the domain, they could just come back to me and hold me like civilly or criminally liable if I'm violating the DMCA or things like that, which I'm not. I wouldn't do that. But there's more complications if you're the one registering the domain in the Whois address book. Address book's probably the wrong word, but anybody familiar with domain name registration probably understands the concept that once you register a domain, it's in your name and there's a monetary transaction tied to it, so they can always tie that back to your identity if they ever need to get a hold of you. I just haven't seen the need to do that for my particular branch of this, or my particular fork of Leela or LeechS. The code works fine. I just don't need the whole secure aspect to it. So you see, there's a lot of steps involved. In hindsight, yeah, I mean, this is correct. This is the right way to address the simple build tooler package launcher defect that we noted. Where if you have simple build tooler options and you have Java options and they're not respecting one another, here's a way to make sure that they respect one another. And this actually works perfectly well, and was eventually included into the simple build tool launcher source code. So they applied my fix, but they applied it in a different way and chose not to give me credit. So whatever, I don't care. But yeah, this fix is still noted here. So apparently some developers for LeechS tried to set up a vagrant sandboxed build. I'm not so familiar with that. I've had some pretty negative experiences trying to use vagrant for really complicated things. I'm sure it works really well for simple applications, but for what I've been trying to use it for, the idea of using a container and then setting up an entire environment using the container, I mean, look at the comic commit strip, and you'll see plenty of comics about that concept. And there's just some complications there therein. Yes, there's some troubleshooting for Git. I'm not sure what this is about. I've not seen this, but it's probably a Windows thing. Oh yeah, it's a Windows thing. So, not sure why, but anyway, you could use the Linux subsystem for Windows, I'm pretty sure. I've not done that before, but it should work, maybe. Look at me giving these great guarantees. I'm not profoundly attached to Windows, we'll say. It works great if you're doing large scale things, and you're using entire if you're entirely committed to using a Windows set of libraries and tool chain and so forth. Works less well if you're trying to do anything outside of that. Partially by design, I assume, but I'm not sure. Still not done, so let me see, what else can I do? Some more vagrant advice. I'm not sure. Vagrant, really, to me, I mean, the fact that they even called it that is kind of interesting. What else? Don't want to bash that for too long, because a lot of people are fans of it. it does work well for simple applications where you don't have to construct an entire environment. Let's see, importing code. Oh yeah. So doing development in IDE does make sense. I just happen to be using a command line instead, but certainly, yeah, you could use the simple build tool. If I had to guess, it probably does work better in Eclipse than it works in NetBeans. I mean, you've heard me on my stream repeatedly bash Eclipse and speak about how I enjoy working with NetBeans. But this is, if you're using third-party tools like the simple build tool, those sorts of things tend to integrate better into Eclipse, where, for the sake of third-party tools, they tend to change how the IDE works and make it work well with a variety of third-party tools, as opposed to NetBeans, where they have a more conforming way of telling you, here's how you use these tools. If somebody wants to write a plugin, it has to conform to these specifications. And it's all very open in that regard, that anybody could submit a plugin as long as it conforms to all the standards and support and so forth. But wow, it's still compiling. Great. Oh, I forgot. I've got tests running in the background. They're chewing up three of my cores. So this is all being done on a single core, essentially. Or there's a lot of contention for cores. My mistake. Also, I turned off parallel building. Although that was just for GCC and the GNU tool chain, so that really shouldn't apply to what I'm doing at the moment. But anyway, yeah, using IDEs is probably better than doing things from a command line, unless you really know what you're doing, which you probably have to do for this kind of project. But yeah, IDEs are great. Don't code without them, unless you have a good reason to. Or build your own IDE. Some people do that. So in terms of setting up a web server, you have to like set up a hosts file and make sure that it redirects these particular host names to your local machine, which we assume is a 127.0.0.1, but you could have it at a different IP address if you want to put that differently somehow. Here's how you specify LeechS running on port 9663. Here's how you specify static content that's located like the 404 pages here somewhere. At least I was pretty sure it was. Well, apparently not. Anyway, you don't need to say happy zero. It's In fact, I installed my LeechS instance under home slash lila. That's where I packaged, or packaged is the wrong word. It's where I have it installed. Is it home slash lila? And then under that, we've got the Lila repository. So it's home slash Lila slash Lila. You don't have to have home happy zero projects. You could be unhappy and you could still use this. But it's illustrative in any event. I'm curious, actually, would it make more sense for this to be located under slash home or slash Etsy, or what would be the best place to install it? I haven't thought much about that. Probably won't think much about that in the future. But things to consider if you're doing serious system administration sort of work. Otherwise, just take something and make sure it works on your machine. Just what I've been doing. Here's how you create application.conf. Says what domain to use, and note later on where we have to define the host file, it says how to make sure that these redirect to the local machine so you're not going across the internet and back trying to find your own machine. Yeah, and then step one is just, I know I've been going through these in reverse order. This is the simplest of them. Just fork the Leela project on your computer. So git clone. Now you don't even have to fork it on GitHub. You can just get your own local clone. It doesn't unless you're actually making changes that you want to make a GitHub version of the Leela repository and then follow all the steps below, such as building dependencies, compiling, obtaining dependencies using gulp in terms of UI dependency code, doing a UI build, optimizing the JavaScript. Wait, yeah, no, I think that's right. I don't even know if I have this step, this SVG optimize. Or it says also install SVG cleaner. I've not installed that yet. So this step 8 might be new. At least to my knowledge, I don't think I've installed it. Oh my god, it's still compiling. Okay. Well, I'm not sure what to do. How's everybody doing? Okay. So yeah, and then you have a GeoIP database that was installed, I think, as one of the dependencies under build dependencies. So this, I think, is used to translate IP addresses to countries and such, or to locales. That's the point. So if a person is logging in from, say, France, they'll get the French locale. So that's the whole point of having a GeoIP database. I'm trying to think if any of the rest of this would not only merits explanation, but is something I can explain in the time it'll take to install this. I guess we could go through what this is doing. So let's see. Scrolling up. So we're checking out all the submodules one at a time. And apparently you get this detached head message because I must have broken something at some point. Our monitoring tool solution is kmon.io, or io.kmon in this case, which allows us to get interesting performance graphs and metrics, analytics. Anything else worth pointing out in here? So GFC, I'm not familiar with. Okay. GFC server. Anything else? Is there something else in here that I understand? I know I'm not a web developer. I keep saying this because I have a lot to learn about web development, but I'm very good at development in general, and I understand how computers work, how systems work, how software works. It's just I'm not familiar with these particular libraries. So there's the GeoIP being updated as the library to access the GeoIP database. So yeah, Scala's always as stable as it is, they're always working to improve it. So I'm guessing that's the point of these warning messages that are in third-party libraries, such as this Hasher library. That's okay. The third-party libraries are giving warnings because Leechess has already analyzed these and said they're suitable for our use. And of course, as they upgrade, we will upgrade our releases accordingly as it makes sense for us to do so, and it often does. All right. Trait build is deprecated. Oh, I forgot. There was a change I was going to apply. You remember that change I put in the stash saying that AIs shouldn't instantly play against each other all the time? I have yet to put that into this version of the code. So I'd have to type git stash apply, to take that change out of the stash and reapply it to my local branch. But yeah, we see that we're building all the modules, like the performance statistics, which I think track. I'm not exactly sure what that tracks as opposed to ratings. I think ratings is just a subset of performance statistics. There's bookmarks on LeeChess. There's admins are able to play ban players. Players can search through games. They can explore openings and end games. They can watch games live on TV. I'm not sure what relation is used for. History, I think, is pretty self-evident. It could mean a variety of things, and I'm not sure which of those it means. Pool refers to the ability to play against players from the lobby. Just hit a button and you get put into a pool and automatically paired with an opponent. Puzzle, we all know what that means. The sets of tactics puzzles. Notify refers to the subsystem for sending out notifications when events occurs. I think shut up is the module for muting players for various reasons, including spam. Timeline is the history you see in the left sidebar in the lobby saying this is what's happened recently. Coach is the coaches page to help players and coaches meet one another. Message is the messaging platform we use. Plan, not sure. Analyze is the analysis module I've done a lot to help with. I'm actually more focused on the Stockfish AI, which is no longer directly integrated. It's now integrated through the fishnet. But analyze, I think, detects when users are requesting analyses, as well as presents those analyses back to the user. And it leverages the fishnet library that Niklas Fieldus developed. Then there's QA. You've all seen the Q&A. It's kind of, sort of, not exactly a Reddit format where anybody could submit a question, anybody could submit an answer. Questions get upvoted, questions get downvoted, answers get upvoted, answers get downvoted, and a best answer is selected by the person submitting the question. And when I say Reddit, I actually mean that that's more like Stack Overflow. Blog is the Prismic.io. Well, I'm trying to find a word other than blog to describe it, but it's got an RSS feed. You can subscribe to it, I believe. Notifications go out when there are new entries in here, but this is where recent updates are broadcast to the world. Evaluation, again, leverages the whole fishnet thing. This has nothing to do with annotations as far as I know, but maybe it also, well, at least I don't think its main purpose is annotations. I think its main purpose is just to be able, actually, wait, no. I'm thinking of a different sort of evaluation. No, I'm thinking of analysis. This evaluation, I think, has to do with the cheat detector, I think. I'm not sure. Fishnet, we mentioned, is LeeChess's integration to the distributed AI network. Round is an event notification, internal event notification system. Importer, used for importing PGN, portable game notation files into LeeChess. Just take the text of that file, paste it in, and it automatically gets put into the database, showing that you're the creator. You can later remove it if you want to. You can automatically analyze the game as part of the import. It's very nice. Insight, LeeChess's tool for figuring out how well players perform in all sorts of circumstances. It's very clever. I'm sorry, it's a very powerful tool. I'm sure over time it will be made more clever, but that's not the highest priority at the moment. It's already quite powerful. It, in a sense, brings relational database concepts to LeechS, which is not built on a relational database, so it's very cool. We all know what a simultaneous exhibition is. Those are possible on LeechS, as are tournaments. There's the lobby, which you see when you log in or when you first visit the page. There's studies, which is an enormous development that LeechS has undertaken. Essentially, well, allowing you to analyze games collaboratively with other players and in some ways integrate some subsets of puzzles into them and be able to view engine analyses, and it's really powerful. In a way, online databases are becoming the next generation of chess software. And this is just one step in that iteration, a very large step. Then there's setup, I'm not sure. Oh, that probably is for just setting up a game for like a one-on-one challenge. Or a very particular kind of challenge that doesn't fit our pool constraints. And there's the direct challenge system, and then so on and so forth. And has this compiled yet? Yes, this is compiled, so I don't need to keep going on and on. All right, so my branch compiles. All the dependencies are pulled in, everything there's compiled in parallel. So git status will show that I'm on branch AI user new. I've got 244 commits that I just pulled in from upstream, plus the 25 that I already pushed to the remote repository on GitHub. And I'm going to push this to replace what I already have. Git push. Let's first push master, just because my branch is always going to follow master. And then do something which they say never ever do, but I'm the only one developing on this repository, so I can afford to do this. So I've rebased my branch on top of the master branch, and pushed my copy now to GitHub. And like I said, I could do git stash apply and get that one last change applied, so I'm not automatically doing AI matches. But that's not the focus of today's stream. The focus is that new variant, Flick Chess, which we're just going to see if we can get this working at all. So, clear git remote, actually git branch v lists all our branches. Oh, this got merged a long time ago. I don't need it anymore. Git remote d Nabokov. Git branch delete Nabokov. That got merged a long, long time ago. In a galaxy far, far away. Just kidding, but I noticed that a book title was not properly capitalized, the book being the end game. So that's fixed. That was accepted pretty quickly. I'm not sure why I held on to that branch forever, other than just not being aware of it. Git checkout is the command to get to start using that version of the code, which takes all the changes I did for the AI stuff, which are still all locally stored, and essentially takes my local copy and caches it away. The way any sort of repository would do, and now allows me to work on this branch, which does not have all my changes, right? So, I want to git rebase this branch on top of master. Okay, we've hit a conflict. Great, what do we do? Git status will show us all the conflicts. So we deleted a few files. I'm not sure what the rationale there was. So let's before we get too far, push, origin, nope, and Holbert. Just in case I mess this up locally, I can always go back to the version I have now cached away on GitHub. So let's take a look at these changes and see what they are, what they entail. I'm kind of confused that this developer took so long to make their changes. Like, they're operating on a copy of LeechUS that was 680 commits old, or 860 commits old. I'm not sure what it would take to bring their copy up to speed with the latest database. Okay, so he says added first playable version of Nipsey Jacques. I assume I said that right. I'm probably incorrect. So what I want to do is take whatever he changed here and apply it up here, right? And apparently his change was so complicated that it could not be automatically merged. So it falls to me to figure out what does it mean to take his change, whatever he changed, and apply it. So looking at this, color black, comma white. I'm going to assume he didn't change what colors we're using. So I'm going to get rid of that. Likewise for format, he didn't change the contents of that or the contents of that. He didn't change the contents of Crazy House or Variant. He's probably not intending to change this particular import chess dot, all this fun stuff, but maybe he is. I can't say for sure. So to be safe, the only thing I can do is compare this element by element with what he's got. Well, in fact, let's take the rest of this, right? I'm assuming he didn't touch this particular line. If he did, not sure what to do. So here's what we can do. We can accept his version, but let's try to make his version look more like what the official version is, I guess. Did he intend to change anything here? I can't tell. I'm gonna just assume no. I'm gonna make a blind assumption that I can just scrap this. That he added chess.clock deliberately, although now chess.clock's already imported, so we don't need to do that. And that we can just do like this and be okay. Is that where I want to have these in terms of ordering things? Well, I guess so. I find it interesting that he's importing like PIOTR and Forsyth directly. That he's not, I don't know, like he must be referencing those somewhere in here. And if he's not doing it in this revision, maybe in the next revision. Either way, I think I've merged this successfully, or as successful as I'm going to get with it. So let's go on to player.scalar, see what's broken here. Apparently nothing. Both modified this. Oh, round.player. Okay. Oh, so for this to work, he added in human flick. Not sure what else he added. I should probably actually look at what his changes are on GitHub. So let's do that. I did make an initial attempt to figure out what he did. Problem is, like, his commits, he did everything as one enormous commit. Actually, that means I have only a single opportunity to get this right. And I'll know fairly quickly if I got it wrong. So that's in some small way encouraging. So what was our first file where we conflicted? It was game.scala. Let's see, can I find game.scala in this list? Game.scala. Okay, let's load a diff. So, got rid of all those chess imports, got rid of finite duration, and added finite duration. That looks like you didn't make a change there. Not sure what that's about, but that's okay, I don't care. What I do care about is this, in particular this line 8, where we took that out and then added this in. I can't tell exactly what he did there. Let's see. But yeah, I said we'll use the official version, and then if I encounter challenges, then deal with those as they come. Let's scrap those changes as well. In fact, why don't I take a more aggressive approach and just assume that the Lee chess version is correct, unless there are circumstances where it's pretty obviously wrong. So, like, here we've got to add human flick, but I'm not sure that we have to add anything else. Right. In fact, this is where the conflict ends in this file. So we'll assume that that's okay. Oh, hang on. We've got another conflict here. Starting right there. So now we're in round/game.scala, I believe. No, player.scala. Let's load the diff here. Okay, so he added human flick was the key point, and then he added this human flick function, added apply flick, added notify flick. So he's just adding code, and somehow in the addition of said code, he ended up changing a new line character, and it could not be automatically merged. But yeah, what he's intending to do is just simply add code. Like here he added a space, and that threw off the auto-merging logic. So I'm gonna consume that space and then take his code 161 through 150, take those 12 lines, apply it ahead of move finish, and I don't think he was intending to change move finish at all. Like, unless I see something here about human flick, which I'm not seeing, and we didn't see in GitHub either. He's not intending to remove any code, just add code. So we can get rid of older version of move finish and replace it with the latest and greatest version of move finish. And then we want to take a look at round.scala. Okay, so let's, what do we got here? What's our conflict number one? Handle versus handle human flick. And then we got handle down there. Again, I think he added in some spaces, which threw off the automatic merge code. So as handle changed upstream, handle human flick conflicted because we changed the spaces before handle. So let me see what he was trying to do there. We're going to go to round.scala. View that. Nope, I meant to view the diff. My mistake. Round.scala. Load the diff. So again, here's just adding code. He added handle human flick before handle. So I want to take this signature, put it down here. I don't think he was intending to change the axis modifier of handle. which must have changed upstream as I'm rebasing this code. Although that does raise questions, like if handle is private, then does it make sense for handle human flick to be protected? Probably not. This should probably be private. So I'm gonna try merging it that way. So now if I do git diff, we can see all the changes. So the diff should look more or less like the diff we see in the GitHub view. I'm not sure again what happened there. I want to take a look at that first file, that game.scala. Vim modules, game source main, etc. Game.scala, because I don't think it was intending to change finite duration. That's not entirely right either, is it? It says we're deleting two blank lines, which is not what we're intending to do. We want a blank line here, a blank line there. So that's what upstream... Nope. We don't want to add those either. Was there a space here? How do I get this to show no changes? Or could this just be a difference in new line characters? I'm not sure. Let's take a look at game.scala again. I know I'm being really pedantic about stuff that doesn't need to be worried about. I just don't understand what's the difference between this line that he got rid of, this line that got added. I guess finite duration immediately precedes byte array. So what if we did it like that, which I think, oh, I'm sorry, what upstream had was like this. There we go, now our diff looks a little bit saner. Just ever so slightly saner. Wait, so what changed in game.scala? Nothing changed. Other than maybe some permissions or something of that sort. Git status though. Git set head on that file. This game.scala. Git status. Oh. Oh wait, no, that has been modified. I just got confused. Okay. Git diff will show us what remains. So that's player.scala where we added human flick. Not sure why we got rid of pos.posAt or got rid of flat map. Not sure at all. It seems like we added a space here, so that's why it says plus plus, and it has just a single minus there. So git status. If I can get the spaces to line up, I can actually see what we're doing. So that was at line 100 something. It's at notify flick. So here we are. We added a space that doesn't need to be there. There's probably a difference in new line characters or something, but whatever. I tried to make it line up and it's just not lining up. Yeah, apparently something changed on this blank line, though I can't see what. Maybe it's just that we're adding a blank line. I'm not sure. Move finish apparently changed. I'm not sure that that needed to change. Move finish should probably remain the way it was. So, let's see. Wait, so let me take a look at move finish inside. I guess that's still in game.scala. Move finish. Nope, it's not in game.scala, it's somewhere. It's in player.scala? Is that what we've changed here? Get status, get diff. Yeah, this is player.scala, is what we want to look at. Apparently move finish changed there. Let's load that diff. Oh, wait, never mind. So here's the old function signature from Whereas, yeah, I think this is something that's changing, but not because of this branch. It's because we're rebasing code, and the code we're rebasing on top of is itself changing for good reasons. That's where the merge conflicts happen, is when upstream changes happen, and your particular changes that you're intending to make happen. It's just a big complicated mess. Move finish is down here. Let's see. Yeah, I'm not sure why that doesn't line up either, but it's being changed anyway. Get status, get add modules, round, source main player.scala. And let's take a look at round.scala. Oh, we've already resolved this. Never mind. And you can see what's changing there is we've added handle human flick. In that upstream, they changed the access modifier of handle from protected to private. And what else? We deleted stuff. I will fail to understand why. Like, was it really necessary to delete all those SVG files? A lot of other changes are being made, but I'm not sure that I need to commit deletion of those files. I'm sorry, we didn't. I suppose we deleted it as well as upstream deleted it on the same revision. Well, let's see if this file still exists. So if we load the diff for that file, we changed it, and then upstream it got deleted, is the point. And so yeah, git's saying that you can't automatically merge that. Because upstream changed it, why are you also changing it? Rather, upstream deleted it, whereas apparently we added a new line character and committed the change. Good old Windows, just making things more confusing for you. But yeah, we want to delete this. Wait, why did that? Oh, that did delete. Black king. In fact, I think I can expand this inline. King, comma, knight, comma, queen, comma, rook, comma, bishop, comma. Well, we've already deleted the bishop. Get status. We've already deleted the bishop, so that whole operation failed. Now we want to do the same thing for the white pieces. So we're one step closer. To make sure I actually merge this right, it would not be bad to do a compile step. So let's compile that. So you can see I actually typed a command. It says SBT compile. All I'm just trying to do is make sure that the syntax is valid. I'm not trying to like build the entire UI just yet. But yeah, if I've broken the syntax at this step, then I need to fix my import statements or whatever else I need to do to make this work. All right, resolving key references, 26,665 settings. Fantastic. Again, how's everybody doing? I guess I could take the time to mention just a new development in the software development arena, Steam Greenlight. So you guys remember, Steam Greenlight is the project to help pick new games for Steam. And it makes it a lot easier for new developers to get their products exposed through the marketplace. And yeah, there's a recent development here. Valve is electing to do away with Steam Greenlight. And I'm pretty divided about this. Well, that's not true. I'm against this. I like the idea. Maybe the implementation wasn't perfect, I can't say. But the idea of being able for new developers to make their products visible to other people, it's a great concept. Now, as for whether or not the particulars of the program made any sense, okay, so here's Kotaku talking about this. Once set up, developers will pay a recoupable application fee for each new title they wish to distribute, which is intended to decrease the noise, the submission pipeline. So, yeah, basically you submit like a $100 fee, submit your game to Steam Greenlight, participates in the program, and until such time that it's, I don't know if games ever get rejected out of Greenlight. But until such time as it gets accepted, I guess you don't get your feedback. And once it's accepted or rejected, I'm not sure. Either way, you get your feedback at the end of the program for being a good participant and following the guidelines and rules and all that. But apparently, I don't know. Says, oh, so no more courting users to get their precious upvotes. I mean, you just admit your games directly to the store and people buy it or choose not to buy it. But, and they talk about we're not sure how much we're going to charge for this new program called Steam Direct. I'm not choosing to focus too much on Kotaku at the moment. They do a good publication. I don't want to steal their material, but just to highlight on what's going on there. Greenlight is making it, used to make it really easy for developers to submit things, and the general public to say yay or nay, before a full game was completed. And I think that's a fantastic opportunity and must have filled some gap in the market, even though there wasn't previously. I mean, back in the 90s, you could get these CDs in the mail for a thing called Software of the Month Club. You could get software, all these demos, and then once you got the demo, you can choose to purchase the full version. But aside from that kind of subscription, I'm not sure of a precursor for this sort of thing existed. But it seemed really exciting to allow developers to submit things to this program, which I don't think Steam did a very good job. Making people aware of this Greenlight program. I know I've tried to search the Greenlight store before, and just got frustrated using the search controls trying to find the sorts of things that I would like. Because the sorts of games that I like aren't the sorts of games that everybody likes. Like, a lot of people like first-person shooters and action games and so forth, and well, you've seen my stream, you know the sorts of games that I play that aren't of that sort of nature. I play the sorts of games that don't necessarily sell so many copies, but have a loyal following amidst fans. And it's unfortunate to see Greenlight go because, I mean, now what can we do? I guess we go back to developers have to submit a full game to the marketplace for whatever they choose to charge for that. Now, what if you want to just make a demo game? And then if enough people are interested in said demo, then you go ahead and develop the full game. This would have a similar effect to Greenlight, except now you have to pay like whatever Valve chooses to charge as the full application fee, and then they have to deal with the complexity of the complete store and all that. I'm assuming, and I'm perhaps assuming too much, that what happened behind the scenes is that developers got really good at making trailers and then didn't have the best time delivering on what they promised that they would deliver. Okay, that's a different thing. And I get that nobody wants to be in the middle of that kind of divide. You don't want to say, yeah, developer, go ahead and make your game, the whole community loves it and wants it. And then if they actually didn't want it, they're rejecting it after you've built it, you put all this time and effort into building it, then the store has to refund all the copies that the consumers didn't want, and it looks bad for everybody. It looks bad not just for the developer who completely whiffed on their promise. And I'm not naming any names here, but you know who I'm talking about. I'm just assuming that, well, actually, there have been a couple of cases like that, so you might not know exactly who, but it's one of those two. That sold hundreds of thousands of copies of a game, and consumers, after purchasing it, decided, oh crap, this isn't what I wanted. Which happens more often than we are comfortable with admitting. It's a reality that that will happen sometimes, but it shouldn't. I don't know. Developers should act in good faith, as should the store, and this is where things fall apart and all the blame gets cast to one side or the other. And it's unfortunate that that happens. Okay, I broke something. But yeah, I think it would make sense not for. I mean, I think it would make more sense to improve Greenlight, to like create separate categories for trailers versus demos. And if enough people. You could have different criteria even for what's considered acceptable based on a trailer, what's considered acceptable based on a demo. You could even have a promotion process where you require a trailer to get a demo, or you require a demo to get a trailer, or something of that sort, or you could require both to get accepted into the marketplace. I don't have a strong opinion there, but I think Greenlight, it's too young to kill. There's too much opportunity there. I think other gaming platforms will be taking away from the slack that Steam is now, or Valve is now, making. It's a market opportunity, and I think people will take advantage of it. It just might take time. Nobody knows when, but I think something will eventually supplant that. So is there a cheat detector somewhere in here? Okay. I'm gonna assume that he didn't write all this cheat detector code. Maybe I'm wrong. Cheat detector. I mean, he certainly added that, but I'm fairly sure that in the copy of the code that he was revising, that there was already some cheat detection code in there. That he didn't just completely invent that on his own. Yeah, so like, move, finish, do all these things, and call, including calling cheat detector. So he's saying move, finish, do all these things, and the first of those is calling cheat detector, but now, if I'm rebasing, I'm working on trying to get a public copy of this Flick chess variant. Because I want to play with it and see how it works. So you can kind of see from the screenshot, I don't know if I'm legally allowed to show the video. It depends how he uploaded this to YouTube and whether he intends to sue me or not over it. But yeah, you can drag a piece and flick it toward your opponent. That's the basic idea. So I'm trying to merge his changes into my project and see how well this works. It could be messy. So, this whole thing about a cheat detector upon a flick finish probably doesn't need to be there. Move finish does all these sorts of things, so let me grab this 36 through 29. Drop that in here. Oh, this looks quite different. Okay, let me try writing this section of the code from scratch. 46 through 17. So if I'm just writing this new function from scratch that we're going to call human flick. Let's see, does this look the same? If I get rid of the word flick, the method signature slightly changed. Oh no, that's okay. Instead of taking a human play, it takes a human flick, which is okay. Yeah, it's pretty weird. It's pretty out there, not gonna lie. And by scratch, I mean I'm taking this one line at a time, because there's just too much to figure out. Okay, so instead of having a UCI move, he has a flick. That's cool. Some of these more Lee chess specific constructs like a POV, point of view, and trace and so forth. Actually, let me try coding this, see what I come up with, and then see if that in any way corresponds to what he did. Apply flick is going to apply a flick using the flick by the name of flick, or using the human flick by the reference flick. Is there anything else related to moves here? Move or drop. What did he do there? F, comma C. I'm not sure that that's going to work. I think those used to be two separate options for a flick versus a something. I'm not sure. F comma C. I mean, certainly saying take three parameters. I just don't remember in the older versions of the Lee chess code, did this used to say something else? Oh, I'm sorry. The reason I was going down here is to see what F and C were used for. And do I need both of them? I might. I can actually see how this used to work. Oh, C would be a color. Okay. Wait, no, that's not right. It used to say apply UC. Case progress comma move or drop. And yeah, even with that same method signature, he elected to add here not move or drop but F comma C. So I guess the rest of that code I can't really do much about in terms of trying to keep to the way this used to work. For some reason he commented this out, it seems. Like, I'm assuming this wasn't, like, yeah, if it It's not your turn. You can still wind up and try to flick something. He commented that out for the new code. But the rest of this, yeah, I think seems to follow the way it used to work, even though there's no method here for cheat detector anymore. So, save progress. If we have an AI, pardon me. If we have an AI do some stuff, you know, that's not part of how this works. I'm curious how that would even work with an AI. I'm not sure the AI would be able to handle this sort of game. This isn't Scala. This is leechess.org. It's a very popular chess website, almost entirely written in Scala. So why does there is I'm trying to merge in another developer's changes, which are operating in an older version of this code base. I'm trying to understand what was that developer thinking. They did commit everything in a single commit, so there's only one commit revision comment explaining what he did and how he did it. So it's a bit of an adventure to figure it out. So apparently he changes this function from move finish to flick finish, does all these extra things. I think that's okay. Oh, I get. This is why he commented out this line. Because flicks are not moves, so it is always White's turn. That's the point. Yeah, we're not playing with turns, we're playing based on flicks. Sorry, it's always White's move. Takebacks. I can only imagine what takebacks would look like in this variant. Actually, you'd be taking back moves, right? Oh, you can make this really confusing. Make it so you can only flick pieces on your opponent's turn or something stupid. And anyway, takebacks aren't going to happen. Not in this variant. So, anything else? Is there anything related to moves here that needs to be changed into the word flick? So he called this F and C, and then he has notify move, which needs to be notify flick. Flick color progress.game. The game's not going to progress, but that's okay. Color flick just to indicate what the move was that got played. I think that's okay. Probably a lot of these things don't need to be happening. So I'm fixing some compile errors and hopefully have fixed it properly. We'll find out in a minute. Compile. Show me all the things I broke. Just probably a lot of things. Okay. Cheat detector not found on. Wait, no, I'm sorry. That's the previous compilation attempt. So, yeah, I'll just show the screenshot again. You click a piece, drag it, and throw it toward your opponent's pieces. And as you do so, it toggles the clock. And if you hit. If your piece hits an opposing piece, they're both removed from the board. Other than that, I don't have any idea how it works. Could be fun, though. Also, I'm not sure if you can actually win by eliminating. I don't know what the win condition is. But no, it looks silly. I'm not sure how you would store these moves. There's a lot of questions up in the air about how this would work at all. So in order to even try to demo this, I've got to merge. Let's get his name. Nerevan. I have to try to merge his code into my code base just so I can run it and test it out. Oh, hey, look, we got more compile errors. That's okay. Oh, blur is now removed. Okay. I missed that detail. Line 50. Oh, blur here. It's not defined. Human flick is going to have the attributes player ID, flick, call, lag. Now, what was call for here? Oh, call would be color. Apparently, color is now blur. I don't know where color is now coming from, but I think that's okay. Unfortunately, when you have like five names for the same concept, it's difficult to keep track of everything. But let's try compiling that. And surely we're missing more stuff. So yeah, I'm just trying to get his code changes up to the version of the code that I'm using, which has a particular schema. If I had like multiple machines, multiple environments, I could just check out his code on a separate machine, a separate environment, and try it out that way. I've got just one machine here though. And this is an argument in favor of containers, is that I wouldn't have to bring his code up to the latest copy of the code just to test it. Although, if we're going to be doing an honest test and assessment on whether or not this could be merged into the actual code base, we need to bring it up to speed. And I don't understand why he didn't do that. Maybe just because it was too much work to do. So, compiling 27 scala sources. We'll see how that goes. So yeah, there's some interest in it. Can't judge a book by its cover. Let me try it, then I'll rate it. Page isn't publicly available. He's saying if you want to test it, get the code yourself, compile it all, and run it. And people are saying, oh, please figure out a way to do this. And I'm like, hey, I figured out a way to do this. Do what he says. Download the code and run it. Admittedly, that was a bit flippant, but I mean, there's a difference between figure this out and, actually do it. Okay. Let's see, how was this initial code handling the AI stuff? I assume he just wasn't sending anything to the AI. If the game has an AI, to the UCI thing, add the move. Well, we don't have a move to add. So we don't need to do that. Had a comment here saying flicks are not moves. No, yeah. Are there any comments in this file? Is there a comment style? I guess the comment style is don't comment. which is kind of disturbing. Wait, notify Flick. Oh yeah, we still have to do the notification. All right. Is anything else broken in that same file? Line 57, which is now 58, because I went down a line. Flick finish, progress game, color flick. Okay, what changed here? Not found, value move or drop. Well, okay, type mismatch. Was expecting a string and found a color. Grep, WR modules. We want to look for flick finish in there. Option two to this method, or the color options, definitely a color. Well, it says it wants a string, and colors aren't strings. So let's take a look at that. Oh, where is that? It's def flick finish. Yeah, this hand expects a color. A flick has a list of an int, a string, and an int. Okay. Apparently that's what comprises a flick. And apparently we got a type mismatch. Not sure where. Let's deal with the easier thing first, which would be line 61, where we're seeing if a player's proposing a take back. Oh, I'm sorry, 61's now 62 because I moved this down line. If the game is forecastable, move or drop, left, so take the move. For each move, forecast the play. This is for like conditional moves, I think. And I can say about this, flicks are not conditional moves, so we don't need to forecast them. Let's try to compile this again, see how far we get. Socket handler line 80 has a type mismatch. I don't know if that's just because I have too many commas or semicolons or something else is horribly failing to parse, but only four errors were found in the last compile attempt. So I'm commenting here that, yeah, there's a way to do it. Just do what he's suggesting, and that's the way. But for anybody who has no idea or understanding, that particular process might be challenging. And so I'm saying, like, well, okay, we figured out a way to do it. The hard part is we got to figure out what's the best way and can Leech us handle it, and then do we want to actually bother with coding and implementing this in here? No, I'm not hacking Steam Greenlight. You know, I think someday something will supplant Steam Greenlight. I think it was an excellent concept. There may have been challenges with the way it was implemented, or the way that Valve implemented it, and that might be why they're choosing to kill it. But I don't think it's something that should be killed, and I don't think it's going to go away. I think ultimately some other companies can do the same thing and have more success with it, and learn from Valve's mistakes, or learn from their own mistakes, but that's my own opinion. No, instead, I'm just coding up this silly chess game here, where you click and drag a piece and chuck it at your opponent's pieces and fun things happen. I'd show the video, but I don't think it's Creative Commons licensed. And since it's not Creative Commons, I can't show it. But, once we get this working, I'll be able to demo it. But isn't coding fun? Said no developer ever. All right, so flick finish. Where is flick finish defined? Somewhere in there. There it is. Player.scala. It's the same file we were just looking at. Expects a game, a color, and a flick. So what was my challenge with this? Other than my challenge is typing at the moment. What was my challenge here? Color evidently wasn't a color. That's my issue. Oh, I've got color alias twice. Okay. That's my confusion here, is that I have color aliased up here, alias down here, and it's just confusing everything. Everything being this down here, which is in this case scope, which uses this particular definition of color. What to do? I could look at how this is originally coded. So this says, I might just grab this code and drop it back in and see how it works. Now that I have a better idea of what I'm trying to do. I could have stashed my changes away or something. Basically, I hit a merge conflict trying to bring that code up to the latest version of the code, so that all the method signatures and database types and everything match up. There was a merge conflict, and I didn't do very well at resolving it, and I'm trying to do better. So, yeah, condition for continuing the game is not going to be if it's your turn. The condition for making a move or attempting to make it, I think this has to be this complicated. I think we have to check. Compare this to the other these GitHub dark colors don't work very well for me. But yeah, for normal chess, you want to just check, are you capable of making a move? For this variant of the game, you want to just see if the game's not over. Because the idea of it being your turn is kind of silly. In fact, let me comment that out. Flicks are possible on opponent's turn. On opponent's move, for sure. I'm not sure if there's I don't know if there's a better way. Okay. What else do I need to do if I'm merging this together? Progress FC. I mean, I get now why you chose C instead of color. I'm just confused which is the right way to handle some of this stuff. In particular, what was failing a minute ago? Somewhere where we were referencing color and it was saying colors of the wrong data type was the problem. So C is used for notify flick. C is not used for anything else. So I'm gonna try what that developer did. I don't like having single letter variable names. I'm very opposed to this, but apparently it's a useful thing to distinguish. I'll call this flick color instead of calling it C. Because I don't like having single letter variable names. They lead to all kinds of confusion. Let's see how this compiles. Also, you see that socket handler has a type mismatch. I'm assuming that's not the fault of anything that was merged in during this rebase operation. Socket handler. Oh, he actually did change socket handler. What did he change? What did he change and why? Okay, apparently there wasn't any functional change. Just a stylistic change, just to drive me mad. Also, sorry for the mouse clicking and unclicking and everything. I don't have my wireless mouse configured just right. There we go, that should work better. So yeah, this doesn't look like a functional change to me. So I can probably do without that. This here looks like a functional change. This also looks like a functional change, but so line 80 is where my issue was happening. I'm going to revert this particular section back to the way that used to work, because there's no reason to change this into three lines. I presumably made some change and then undid it, but didn't change the style back. All right, so socket handler. Think this used to be like this. Or at least that's closer to what we used to have. Round map exclamation point tell game. Yeah, okay. So now I got rid of two lines of code, so I'm going to look at line 78 here where the error happened. Resync. Resync. Resync requires UID.value. Anything else? Think that looks fine. I haven't looked too closely at this. It bothers me that lag. Like, you've got the flick. Yeah, this should be blur, comma, lag. Unless I'm missing something. What do we use color for? Yeah, color is now going to be blur. Though I can't imagine why you would use that here. I suppose you still could. So now I've changed the definition of what it means to parse one of these flick events in the socket handler. So, well, something's gonna fail to compile. I don't know what. But rather than trying to anticipate what the compiler is going to complain about, let's see what it observes as I just broke. Because I certainly just changed a method signature right there, or a function signature. In Java, they're called methods. I think in Scala, they're actually called functions because they're functional. They don't necessarily need to compile into methods. They could optimize just functional programming optimization sorts of ways. Again, there's a screenshot showing what the end goal is. People were asking, why don't you just find a way to do this? The way was found hours ago. We started the stream an hour and a half ago, and we're still getting compile errors, so we're still not at a point where we can test this. The challenge wasn't figuring out how, a way to do it, it's figuring out a good way to do it. Grep define human flick across modules. Need to search recursively to find it. It's not found. Search for human flick. Where can I find the definition of a human flick? Millies is not a member of string. Oh, did I do something dumb? The answer is yes, but the question is how. Flick blur lag. Okay, so it's the whatever's consuming this is passing in. What gives? What gives? Something strange about the way I'm defining this. Oh, case class human flick. Here it is. Which explains what a human flick is. I changed up the definition of this slightly in accordance with not needing to get the color in that, but we just wanted to know whether or not there was focus on the window or there was a blur. All right, let's compile again. I'm sure that breaks something else. And I'm sure the reason that that developer didn't bring everything up to the latest version is because it would take time to do so. But now we're finding that for me, another developer, it takes time to do so. So it would have been nice for him to bring it up to speed, but not essential. Not as long as I can figure this out. If I hit a brick wall, then, well, then we're not going to get a nice demo now, are we? But hopefully we'll have a better outcome than that. One can hope. Ideally, I assume that he's been working on this for quite some time. And obviously, this couldn't be developed overnight. It must have been a large effort to come up with what he did. And so it makes sense he wants to get it out there and just see if there's any interest at all. But what surprises me about that is can't you just, show us a video that doesn't necessarily entail a Lee chess-based demonstration. You could kludge together some much kludgier way than the way he did it, and say, is there any interest whatsoever? And, at that point, if the answer is no, then fine. But once you've taken it this far and showing, hey, I got it working. Oh, by the way, I'm not gonna let you play with it and see how it works. That's unfortunate. Because that means more work for developers here. I'm not saying I even am obligated to do this, I'm just curious. Oh, human flick. Yeah, argument 3 is going to be a blur, but oh, that's defined over an actor API. That's not what I was looking for. I thought human flick was in my copy-paste buffer. Apparently not. Did I somehow fail to define this? Human flick. It's constructed using a blur, which is of type Boolean. Okay. I'm confused. A flick, it says, is a list of int, a string, and an int. Apply flick requires a string. We're gonna spend all our time in the modules package anyway. Let's start here. Where's apply flick defined? Okay, that's where it wants a string, even though elsewhere we know that we need a Boolean. Apply flick. So this needs a Boolean for blur. Whoops, didn't mean to go beyond that. Let's see. I'm sure that's going to break other things, but. Oh, wait, color was the variable name of the thing I was looking for. This is going to be blur colon boolean. Apply UCI. Whew, this is going to get complicated. Okay. Equals. So what am I looking for? Color match, match, etc., etc. I'm disposing with color though, so there's got to be a better way to do this. Oh, but I don't have a move. I do still have the flick. The flick could tell me what color we're using. So what did I change here? String. It's not the flick that I wanted to change. It's this here where we say color colon string. This needs to be blur colon boolean to be more consistent with how the rest of everything works. So a compile error now is that color here is undefined. Maybe I need to have both. Ideally, this flick construct would contain contain more than it does contain. But I think part of what we need to pass in as part of this update operation is going to be whether or not the opponent went off the screen. Update flick takes that, but what are these other two used for? Okay, well, and this isn't indented the most useful way either. We match on color, do this stuff based on color. Then we match is the same move, which, I mean, clearly it isn't a move. But we could find no moves, and that's okay. I think this should be like that. And then we check, what do we have left over? If what we have left over is we've got a chess game, and we've got a move or a drop, which we don't have. Do some more stuff. More stuff we're doing is check the color of the game clock. And if it's a given color to move, then do a update flick operation. Case sum C. I'm assuming that game dot. I don't know what to assume anymore. Game dot clock. Case sum C. Ultimately, if we're going to perform an update, we need to know whether or not the opponent blurred, because that's something that's recorded each time we do an update. What a mess. Okay. But otherwise, if we don't find a match, then we're returning null. Oh, so here we create a fake move. Not that we're going to transmit the move itself, but constructing a move allows us to later. Okay, I get it. My goodness, that was confusing. But okay. Now, as for the game clock use of this C, I'm not sure. Case where we have a game clock, I guess, is where we're gonna do something. We don't even necessarily use the C anywhere. Let's see, but if we have something, that's the point. It's not the color, it's just any arbitrary thing that we have as the game clock. Then go ahead and allow the player to do perform a flick. Otherwise, just don't do anything. And also return null. Not sure if that return null is necessary, but whatever. That's how that developer implemented that, and now we're going to try to compile again. We'll get there. Might take us a few hours, but we're making progress. Oh, hey, look, it compiles. Ain't no way that that runs. Just saying. But in terms of having merged code, I don't know whether I preserved the intent during this merge, but I damn well tried. Git add this. Git add that. Git add this. Now I could continue rebasing, or I could test whether this works in its current form. We're in the middle of a rebase operation. I think we need to test it. Well, it's not going to test though, because my schema is out of date with the changes. Okay, so how do we test? Git diff. Cached on this directory shows us everything that's changed. Apparently, a whole bunch of bin directories got added, and a whole bunch of other crud got added. All these extra lines got added, and whatever. I'm confused about. So we're doing a rebase operation, right? Well, never mind. We'll see at the end product, and then if my suspicions are correct, we'll see if that end product makes no sense. Git rebase continue. Okay. Status. Our changes have diverged, where I have 861 local changes. That master has one local change. I'm A-okay with that. Let's see. Git push origin, my branch. Origin is not going to be the remote that we got that from. Okay, so that compiled. I've stored a copy away there. Now, for a more practical matter, git remote-v. I don't want to be tracking this remote branch anymore. Git checkout master, git remote. Get rid of nHolbert. Get remote delete. No. Remove. Remove is the keyword here that we're looking for. Remove that. I'm gonna add it back later. Get branch dash v, show all my branches. Get branch dash d to get rid of that branch. It observes that this hasn't been merged into master yet, so are you sure you want to delete it? Yes, we're sure. Git pull. Oh, I'm sorry. Git fetch. Actually, we already know what's on the origin. We've already just pushed to it. So git checkout. nHolbert. And then we can. Add back the remote repository. Not that I'm going to use that anytime soon, but I could use that to compare my changes to the ones he changed. So, that said, I still have my local file, this install.sh, that just does a lot of things automatically, so I don't need to manually do them. So we just finished the rebase. Now we're going to compile everything, including the UI. So build all that stuff. This can take a minute. But yeah, fortunately, in fact, we could go to GitHub and see just how well I did. Let's go there. GitHub. Leela's the repository name. Hey, look, we have a recently pushed branch. And we're already two commits behind master. How far behind are we? Upgrades. Oh, that's scary. Holy. I dodged a bullet. Dodged a bullet. Although, well, I've got a bad feeling about this. Oh, never mind. That was just two files in that submodule. I can survive without those two changes. I could probably survive with them also. I was thinking that upgrade to scala-chess would entail, well, scala-chess updated its dependencies and all kinds of stuff is going on there, but no. That's not the case. Okay. I wonder, playing this Flick chess variant, I could play against the AI, and it'd be kind of fun to have an intelligent AI to play against, which is aside the point, but like say you're losing a chess game, you could like flick one of your pieces in the directions of your opponent's king, and just see what happens. see if this new branch of the code lets you get away with that sort of nonsense. Because that could be fun. Yeah. Like I said, the only reason I'm doing this is just to see how it plays, just for the fun of it. It's unfortunate that this has taken a couple hours just to get to the point where I'm even in a position to start testing it. But I think we better understand the code because of it. And that's just advanced my understanding of like how all these pieces fit together in general. So there's a little bit of fun to that, though not very much, because, well, you're just learning how this particular code works. Other projects could be structured differently, though they could be structured similarly, so there could be some gain from learning all this. So, the thing we learned is that this takes about, I don't know, it takes a few minutes to compile. I'm not sure if there's a way to accelerate this build process, though normally you're not building the entire project, essentially. Normally, it's a lot simpler to do this build because you haven't changed all the source code files. So if you're curious, I do have a Lee Chess instance on my local server. So we get this nice little message indicating when my server is down. I mean, at one point I did customize this message to have my server name as opposed to the Lee Chess server name, and eventually that got lost in all the changes that happened. That's still compiling. Let's see what's new in the world here. That's cool. I'm not interested in that at the moment. There's always a thousand things going on. I'm not pursuing those particular two things very closely at the moment. Oh, are we getting there? We're probably not. Let's check out what else is going on in Lee Chess. So, yeah, I saw a comment 2 hours ago. People, again, are enthusiastic about this variant, if anything can happen with it. Suppose I don't need that screenshot anymore. I don't need to, well, I don't need GitHub open at the moment. Let's check out the Q&A. Lost two games in two different tournaments without being paired. Sounds a lot like a person lost their connection, but I'm not a moderator, so I don't know the details. I can't access the server and see, hey, what happened on the production server for this particular tournament. That's something really only a moderator would know. Where can I find the rules of each variant? This hasn't been answered yet. I mean, the answer is go hover over that variant name, but if you want a list of rules for all the variants, I'm not sure where to find that. iPad app improvement request. See, that's not a question. But do you please? Yeah. Right. Playing board could be on the right side of the screen instead of the left. The idea is you want to submit these sorts of requests into the feedback forum if you want people to discuss and actually do them. So, I mean, we could take a look at some puzzles if we got time. We do. So, let's see. We got Queen D3. I assume the solution is just C7 followed by Rook B8. If C7 Queen A6 happens, not sure what to think about beyond that. So I don't know if White has enough force to overcome that. That's sort of the tricky part of this is it's just evaluating the situation. But if it's not c7, there's no other candidate move here. Like, I don't know, if I play queen b1 on move 1, does that really do anything? I've seen this puzzle before too, and I think I failed it last time, which is why I see it again. But yeah, if I do queen b1, we exchange queens, and he plays rook c8, and I lose my pawn. So I think I have to lead with c7. Then follow with rook b8. Well, no, c7, rook c8. Rook b8, queen a6, and I'm not sure what to do next. Let's try c7. See, that doesn't seem very testing here. Appearances could be deceiving. I could be wrong, but looks like I just played my rook up. Oh no, my king is being attacked. I think this is where I failed it last time. Maybe queen b1. Yeah, this is where I failed it last time. I just promoted and said, to heck with it, white's winning somehow. But queen b1 wins on the spot. Or was it that queen b1 ran into rook a1? Is there any reason not to take a queen here? I mean, so this is the hard part of the problem. Is do you allow rook g2, take the rook, then black starts checking? Which I think is dealt with pretty swiftly. I think that that's not a very solid try. Do you like promote to a queen right away? Ultimately, the answer to this is you have to actually look at the variations. Like, queen b1 pitting the queen, rook a1 pitting the queen, queen takes rook, queen e3 check. And is there a way out of those checks? I'm not sure. Because if you just take a queen right away, if you promote, you're probably winning this. Although rook a1 is still a problem. Maybe it could be dealt with. I'm not sure how. I don't see the answer. Let's see, is this done compiling? No, it's not. Okay. So, what does white do? I mean, yeah, I could win a rook with queen b1, rook a1. But surely I have higher goals than that. At the same time, if I promote immediately, my queen gets pinned anyway, and it seems to be a perpetual check that follows. Unless my king escapes to the queen side or something. But it would not it be escaping either way if I play queen b1 or I promote here. Can't I always just run the white king over to b1 and then a2 and escape somehow? I'm gonna promote because I don't see any of this. Okay, this is the best move. So black intends rook d1 here. And I think I just play rook b1 to counter that. The c3 pawn is doubly defended. So let's protect d1. Oh, that failed. Is it queen b1? No, it's not queen b1. I could swear that rook b1 wins. No, it doesn't, because there's a per in fact, white gets mated. Queen b1 is a stronger try, but it loses the queen, and you fall to a perpetual check, probably. Yeah, the move I picked was suboptimal, to put it lightly. And to put it harshly, it was one of the worst moves on the board. So what do I do about this rook d1 versus queen e3 stuff? How do I deal with that? I don't check. I mean, I've got to deal with these threats. I can't just let this go completely ignored. And we already tried Queen B1 to pin the queen, which just loses material, and gets to perpetual check. Well, surely it's not Queen H8, right? If Queen G8 fails, Queen H8 equally fails. Now what do I do about this stuff? Is it Queen F1? No. I'm just guessing at this point because I'm completely out of ideas. Other than I can't just allow this to happen. That's my only idea, is that White's in a challenging spot here. It's not very useful. Oh, I just take the rook. How is that? I don't know. Somehow that must improve upon the other stuff we were looking at. Now to get out of the perpetual check, you have to bring the queen back. But how is that any worse than? Oh, okay. Queen H8, you can't bring the queen back. Likewise, Queen G8, you're stuck. Rook B1 gets mated. Queen B1. Not sure why Queen B1's inferior. I think it's just down a tempo, and that's a really important tempo. So this draws, as do the Queen G8 and Queen H8. They also draw. Rook B1 gets mated. Queen F1. I think just draws again to Rook D1. I was trying to figure out, well, surely it's not this because this is not an option here anymore. Once Rook D1 is played, then you'd have Rook takes Rook. So, yeah, tricky problem for sure. Are we done yet? Has this compiled? No, this is not compiled. So, am I merging the code? I don't understand why the compile step succeeded earlier and now it fails. Probably an error in my methodology. Either way, I gotta fix all this. So, let's get fixing, shall we? What would I even need? Like, let's take a defi look at the definition of apply flick. Apply flick is defined in modules. Modules round source main player dot scala. We're looking for apply flick. It's defined down here. It claims to need a color as well as the blur. And the reason it has the color is to differentiate later, like, what's the move that, if we were to make a move, what would the move be? And apply that move. So we'll keep that, I guess. Oh, update flick is the thing I want to look for. So let's search for update flick in modules. That's a lot of text to read, so let's look at it this way. All right, here's def update flick, defining game.scala. Indentation's different because this person was editing the source code using something on Windows, I'm sure. So we got like. Well, these aren't even tab characters. This is just a different indentation. You can do it that way. Progress equals stuff. That's huge. That's a lot of code. Okay. Where is color used here? Oh, we got an event.flick, which has a color, and we return progress using that event.flick. So events in this version of LeechS don't have a color associated with them anymore. Like, as far as I can see, well, I'm sorry, there's a state. The state has a color, but the event itself doesn't contain a color. Oh, so many distinctions. So many distinctions. Grip, flick, and modules. So let's take a look at what our various events are. Wait, what do we have for moves? So when we create an event, event.move and event.drop are our types. So let's use like drop as an example. Case class move. Let's take a look for class drop. So here's class drop. Can I compare this with flick? So we get object drop immediately following that, possible moves, and so on and so forth. Let's grab this, these 158 through 138. And then find class flick somewhere in here and see what's the difference. Other than indentation, which apparently is different for that author than from everybody else who's been editing the code. Okay, why does it need color? Apparently it does, just some reason. It's defining its own data structure as to what's in a flick. Now, where do I store? I guess these moves don't store whether a blur happened or not either. This does have a JSON encoding. Convention followed elsewhere is that parentheses goes here. Now why, I guess somehow we still care about color here. So I'll stick with the convention that followed for drops and apply that to flicks. This extends event. See, I'm not seeing a big problem here in terms of data representations changing. So let's just hope that that works and compile it again. And see where it breaks this time. In fact, everything had compiled just fine until I started pulling in the UI code. Right? That's where we saw our problems here is when we... Oh, sorry, this isn't UI code. This is just base code. So if I do like sbt compile, I should have gotten that error the first time. I'm not sure why I didn't. But that means we're gonna get to do some more puzzles while we wait. So I've got Queen B7 winning a bishop but losing a knight. Can I do better? I'm not sure. Like, black's threatening Queen E2 check, and then I'm losing the knight with tempo. Hang on. So if I play this, then black plays King G8 so I don't get this check. Oh, but then I check anyway. And I get to pick up the bishop. That seems pretty reasonable. Okay, I take your bishop, and yeah, that's it. And after King G7, you can check the king away and then run the knight to G6, and white's fine. Maybe there's other ways too. But yeah, the white queen can't cover E2, so likely the king is going to have to be deflected away from G6, so the knight's going to be able to run there. But yeah, white can win that pretty easily. I don't like to upvote problems just because I succeeded at them. I think that one was particularly instructive in terms of helping players identify candidate moves and look for unusual ideas like queen b7 to queen a8 to queen takes bishop. You don't see that every game. At least I don't. Maybe you do. Depends how your games are going. So this knight's defending the bishop, the queen's defending the bishop. I think I've failed this puzzle before. The key here is to get the queen to move away from the bishop so you can win the bishop. So I think it was a6. No, that's wrong. Was it rook takes knight? That's also wrong. Was it knight takes bishop? Nope. Oh, what would it? Oh, it was rook c5 was the key move to this puzzle. Yeah, I did fail this before. I failed it again. It's tricky to find rook c5. It's a good problem. I just don't have the patience to look for that sort of thing while I'm trying to do this at the same time. Not enough arguments to apply flick on player.scala. Okay, so we'll go to line 52 and see that apply flick does indeed require color and blur. I forget in what order it prefers, or by convention we're doing it. Let's see, but the function is apply flick. And we need to do this search recursively. And okay, it's color, comma, blur. So we want a color here, apparently. So there you go. There's a color. Oops. And then compile again, maybe? And show me what else I've broken. I think we need color, comma, blur everywhere. And each compile step should get incrementally faster, hopefully, as we converge, hopefully, and not diverge. As we approach a solution, it should become increasingly clear what that solution is. Okay, so I'm thinking rook c7, and the bishop's defending the knight, and that somehow, like, rook d5, knight f6 wins an exchange. The problem here is that if I pin this knight, that queen takes d3 happens, and I'm losing a knight. Also, I think it's problematic if I do knight takes c5, bishop takes c5, and black's threatening to push the d pawn, also threatening the rook. So, prioritizing everything here with respect to everything is a bit challenging. There's gotta be a way to resolve this. Maybe the answer is that we exchange knights, pin the bishop, rook d5, and then push the a pawn. And that black's just overworked. Maybe it's not an idea of trapping the rook. I know I've seen this puzzle before. And see, black is just like chucking the bishop because that's the best move, but That's not very instructive. What would have been instructive is had black, like, I don't know, played rook d5, tried to hold the bishop, and then you push a7. Obviously, that's worse than just taking the a pawn because white's promoting, but it shows the key idea. On the other hand, giving up the bishop and just knowing that you have to take it is. That's the key. That's in fact the key variation, because without seeing both of those variations, you haven't solved it. And there's no way to know that you saw both, because you only get to provide one of those two moves. Type mismatch. Color needs to be a string. Okay. This is where things get ugly. So we're getting color out of where? Where do we get that from? Oh. Get that out of the POV object, which apparently does encode color as a string. Well, that's unfortunate. Oy vey. This is where it becomes clear that between 600 code revisions, I've lost some of the meaning. Close to 700 code revisions. I've lost sight of data types, of some pretty important attributes. Like, we're getting color out of the POV object, but apparently in a POV, a color is a string? That doesn't seem to make any sense. But if that's the convention, that means that if we need color, we need to get it some other way. Well, do we need color? Apply flick. Oh. No, we're saying we need a string. I'm not convinced that we need a string. This is gonna get ugly. So, I don't want a string. I want these colors. Hopefully, that's the right way to do it. Grep def color modules searching recursively. Maybe it's a class color. Yeah, it's a class color. So there's chess.white and black. I'm sure there are multiple definitions in this project of the names white and black. I'm sure it's going to cause all kinds of confusion, but we'll see if we can handle it. Okay, so apparently I take a knight and then I take a bishop. And I'm up a bishop. I think it really is that simple here. Because I don't have any other capture. Oh, hang on. Rook takes rook. It's an intermezzo. Or intermezzo. Free bishop. Unpin the knight. Well, that was easy. And then white can't follow with this kind of shenanigans because all these squares are covered. All these are covered by the black queen. So b7 is not hanging. And if white instead ignores that and plays rook e1, then you just bring the knight out. Or maybe exchange queens. Maybe you can afford that. Like if rook to e1, exchange queens, bring the king away. White's going to try to race the king to the center, which makes sense. So, exchanging queens might not be the brightest move that Black has here. In fact, if White plays that, maybe Black plays f5 check. And, whoops, damn mouse. Yeah, so maybe Black's losing some pawns this way. Worst case, if he plays like completely obliviously. Although, completely obliviously would also involve f5 check, king e5, and missing this obvious tactic. I think that obvious tactic saves the day in terms of this stuff, so there's not really a way that White can get his king over here before Black can get his king over there. But really, that's the only danger you're looking at, is that somehow this knight being pinned is too much of a hindrance to Black's progress. But, you know, if this pawn were on f6, then yeah, by all means, exchange queens, get the king out here, defend the knight, and then activate your pieces. Or just keep the queens on. And, I mean, you're up a knight. This is the cleaner way to handle it. Alright, how's this going? Alright, case white. Not found, value white. I'll show you now, Vound. Yeah, apparently I need to import various colors. Wait. Grep def white. It's defines. No, it's not. Okay, well, yeah, searching for that's not working. What's there in lobby? Oh, in fact, lobby's the wrong place to look now, isn't it? There's apparently multiple definitions of color. Chess.color. So let's go into modules, chess, source, main, scala, color.scala. Color.white. Case class white extends color. So these are all imported from color, extending color. Let's see. I think my problem is that I'm saying this. I think I need to be more precise and say color white, color black. Because I didn't import white and black, I need to specify them that way. Compile? Alright, next puzzle. What are we looking at? Knight e5. Man, I want to land my knight somewhere up here, but that's not happening. I also want to take e5, take e4, just take all the things. That doesn't look so great either. Bishop takes e5 as a way to limit Black's options to just pawn takes back, but what's the point in that? If there's no gain from it, then why bother? If knight takes e5, knight takes c3, knight takes d7, knight takes rook, knight takes rook, rook takes knight, queen takes knight, that's an equal trade. A fair exchange. Nothing interesting there. What a mess. What a mess. I don't see anything interesting other than knight takes knight, so we're gonna play that. Apparently, Black did not take on c3. I'm not sure if that's significant or not. We'll figure this out eventually. But now, if I take the knight and play d6, and he takes, and I can play c5, I'm threatening to take stuff, but it's not very forcing. to have anything better. Better would be seeing, am I done compiling? I am done compiling. Alright. Type mismatch. Comparing a color to a something. Required string. Oh, can I only do cases on strings? I can't do cases on class types? I guess that makes sense. Because, I see why now. We're learning scale, guys. White is equal to this is equal to white. Black is equal to this is equal to black. Case object. So this is case object white, case object black. I need an example. There's just so much abstraction in this highly functional language that it's hard to figure out some things. Like, if I'm trying to fudge a move based on the clock saying somebody's the color to move, can I do it this way? Oops. I really don't think that's going to work. Oh wait, update flick is where this is failing on 133. So actually, no, my comparison was good. It's a good example of how to use a case and a switch statement. Well, I'm sorry, a match statement. So when I went to actually update things, that color needed to be a string because update flick thought that color is a string. Def update flick in modules. It's in game.scala. Update flick expects color to be a string, no more. That's going to be a color. Now, is that going to cause any issues? Well, so we create an event.flick, and this is where we need to go back to events.scala, or event.scala expects that a flick contains a color of data type string. I'm going to change that to a color and see just how far do we go down this rabbit hole. Like, I think a color can be encoded into JSON fairly harmlessly. Now, I'm not sure why we need that in the JSON, but apparently we do. Or maybe. Okay, I'm just gonna put .asdf here until I look up what's the correct way to get the name out of the color. I'm not even sure if I need that as a string or not, but supposing I did, is there a way to obtain the, okay, yeah, name is just name. I was right for once. Okay, so ASDF is just going to be name. That should be okay. Does this compile? This can be the next question. Answer is probably not. Also, there's dead code following that construct, and it's an error. Oh, right, because warnings are elevated to errors unless I customize the build settings, which I'll need to do, or I could figure out a way to clean up the code. Oh, I'm sorry, we're back to this puzzle. I hadn't solved this yet. Oh, wait, Bishop B4. I did not see earlier. So I want to take this knight and then play bishop b4. And this just wins an exchange. Now, this goes back to my earlier criticism, which was, okay, I took this knight. Black elected not to take my bishop. I don't understand why not. So, I think I've failed this puzzle before as well, and that's why I knew that knight takes knight was the correct move. I just couldn't remember, and was never really shown, well, what if he just takes the bishop? Then what? Apparently I don't need to know that to solve these sorts of puzzles. It'd be nice to know, but I'm not, even having looked at it, was the first thing I looked at was we take the bishop, white takes a bishop, and we're off to the races. I guess black's knight might not be getting out of that, but black gets to take the knight first. So, d takes e5 is the critical line, but I don't understand why. We've got knight takes bishop, knight takes bishop. As I was saying, knight takes d1 seems critical here. And then I evaluated, I guess it doesn't matter which rook, but we could take that one. And, oh, white's up a bishop somehow. Because white was the first player to capture, and the last player to capture. If you're the first one to capture, and the last to capture, and you've been trading equal strength pieces, you come out on top at the end. It's a good trick. If you, like, you get in this huge chain of exchanging all the minor pieces, and exchanging rook for rook, and so forth, it's a useful thing to remember that if you're the first person to capture, and the last person to capture, you're probably coming out ahead. If your opponent was the first one to capture, and the last one to capture, you're probably coming out behind. Alright. Type mismatch. Player.scala, line 58. Whoops. That's not a program. We need to edit the file. Line 58. So, case. Flick color is defined as what? Apply flick. Where's flick color? Case progress flick color. For some reason, we're expecting a string here in notify flick. So that seems unwise. Why would we use a string when we have a color object? Hang on. Nope. Notify flick is what I want to search for. Here it is. It wants color as a string, though that doesn't make any sense to me. I mean, I can understand that a flick could contain a string, but I want a color to contain a color. That's okay. Oh, we're not even using that color here. Notify move just takes a move or a drop plus a gain. Doesn't need the color. Publish a move event with a game ID. Position, a flick as the move, pushable, alarmable, a simul ID. Can you imagine playing a simul and you're flicking pieces everywhere? That could be fun. What else? Opponent user ID. Oh. Well, now we know the opponent's user ID. It's pretty easily defined. Since we know the color, simul ID push this move event. Okay. Now where did we get color from up here? Mover dropped at fold color, etc. Okay, and here we're just getting a flick, which is a int string and an int. Okay, socket handler. Found an int but expected a boolean. Yeah, something's not right. Human flick and modules. So, where's human flick? Case class human flick. It's this human flick has a blur, a lag, a promise. Doesn't have any more than that. It seemed like we were passing in six arguments. Were we not? Player ID, flick, blur, lag, and promise. Player ID, flick, blur, lag, and promise. That's exactly what we're passing in. Okay. So where is this code failing? Drop blur lag, flick blur lag. What's the deal? I'm supposing that parse flick is returning something that is not being very friendly to this. So we gotta drop. We're yielding a thing. Oh, this thing that we're yielding, it looks quite different than, say, what parse drop yields. Okay, so this needs to have a velocity, a key, and whether or not this is a win. Fine. Doesn't need to have a color. So we don't need to have that in parse flick. Just need a D, whatever D is going to stand for here. The velocity, the key, which I guess is the target, I'm not sure, and win is whether or not we won. And then blur is going to be defined this way. Drop blur parse lag for drop. Except object D. Now, why this said object D to begin with doesn't make sense because I guess we just use D overall. D means a drop or move, apparently. All right, so when we parse a flick, we get the D object, the velocity, key, win, and blur, and return all that. A flick. Sure. Well, looks okay now. Not saying it's the best way that that could be done, but it seems okay. I'm sure I still have something broken, but gradually, over a span of now 2 hours and 45 minutes, we're starting to appreciate how that developer made some code changes and didn't leave any comments. But, I mean, they did some good work, but this is why developers are critical of each other. Sometimes very stingily so. Sometimes not. All right, this wins a queen. I'm almost certain I failed that before. I still think it's a dumb puzzle because queen traps are dumb, but whatever. It's not instructive, is what I mean to say. So is this like queen h4, rook g5, queen skewer stuff? Where's a queen h5, rook g5, queen skewer stuff? I don't know. Not sure. Probably queen h5. Oh wait, rook g5 is illegal. That's what got me the last time I failed this. Is that I need to go back here to unpin my rook. And now with the rook unpinned, I can win a queen. There we go. That's clever. That's really hard to find. And in most of your chess games, you're not going to see anything like that. So I'm neither upvoting nor downvoting that. All right, next puzzle. I just want to take d5. It seems like the most violent thing to do in the position. Why would you abstain from playing the most violent move? You'd only abstain from that if it doesn't work, or if there's something better. So, knight b5 seems to win material on the spot. So the question is, what's the right way to capture d4? This is a puzzle within a puzzle. Strong chess players hate this sort of thing, and I'm starting to understand why. I used to think, well, yeah, no, it's great, because a lot of chess positions are actually like this. But it's not very instructive. Unless you happen to be getting a lot of chess puzzles or positions in your games that are of this nature. So I want to say, just knight takes d4, knight takes d4, queen f2. The knight's pinned. Like, if I play queen f2 right away, that doesn't work so well. But if I exchange once here, then I could follow up with that, and I'm doing pretty well. I'm not sure why knight takes d4 isn't part of the puzzle. It seems like finding that move is pretty key, and then finding queen f2 after that's pretty key. Without queen f2, this all amounts to nothing. So I'm actually going to downvote that because it's incomplete as a puzzle. Alright, two errors found. Nipsey Jacques is not a member of PackageChess.Variant. Aha! So we finally hit our first compile error that I didn't cause. Finally hit one. That's not. I mean, there's nothing I could have done to avoid this either. I would have had to know stuff that he hasn't checked in. Yeah, that's a fault not of mine. He needed to create a fork that defines this variant. Wait, no, this is actually not a submodule. This is part of the Lila source code. So we need to define that variant. Modules setup source main variant, I think it was. No. Okay. Grep. Well, actually, get status. Get add all the stuff that's now in here. Get status. Get commit. Something that compiles better, but it's still not up to the standard. So let's say look for racing kings. And let's only include the matches that we find in scala files. Let's see, like, where is racing kings defined? Okay, variant.scala. Um, Racing Kings is defined here somewhere. Nope, it's not. Yeah, he didn't check in something that he needed to check in. So now, I can go back to the forum and say, say that I've did my best. You still owe me some source code. So this is all branched from, they did one big commit. It's opaque as can be, but he missed a thing in modules. Where? Chess source main variant. Chess. Oh, this is a scala chess module. Yeah. So that is a proper submodule. So yeah, I could just give him this error message and say, you know, give me the source code. Because I don't feel like making it myself. Because I'll probably get it wrong. Okay, well, I spent 3 hours merging code. 3 is probably not worth mentioning. Hours is probably worth mentioning. And into, let's see, I merged it into GitHub, Leela, this branch. And ultimately failed to compile. And of course now it compiles. But I think my error earlier was that I was doing compiling from the modules directory. I need to actually compile from the top level directory. Hopefully that's not going to cause any problems. So what's new in the world here? TensorCart is a person's attempt to use TensorFlow to solve Mario Kart. I mean, I get that I'm being a little bit naive in saying, hey, look, I failed to find this variant. Yeah, I could just go make a new variant, but I want to make sure I do it correctly. And the important part of that would be having the game end condition. Also, I'm not sure why he chose to model this as a variant. I know that's historically how LeeChess has modeled these sorts of things. But you could create, like, you have casual games, you have rated games. And you could say for each variant, you're going to have one of these sorts of options. I'm tempted to merging upstream changes in rebasing the changes. So I can use my machine and my MongoDB database. Let's see. And failed to compile. So who kicked off this thread? Who owes me code? Please advise. Okay, there we go. Close enough. Yeah, I think what's probably going to happen with Steam, if I had to guess, and I guess I don't have any internal knowledge of how their stuff works, but I wager, and I'm not putting any money up on this wager either, but to use the figure of speech, I wager that what's going to happen is that people are going to be releasing more demos on Steam, more half-finished products, more things that they can't just show a trailer and say, I'm going to promise the world to you. They have to show a proof of concept that it actually works. And then people will invest their money according to what they want. And so you'll have like game version 1.0, game version 2.0, game version 3.0, and so forth. I assume that where things fell apart with Steam Greenlight is just that players were promised things that were unrealistic. And there's no way to force developers to be honest about what they're going to deliver. So people can express extreme interest in various sorts of games and not so much interest in others. And, you know, if they don't have a demo, what can they do? I guess then when the game actually reaches the store, the players have a different idea as to what they wanted than what was actually shown in the green light. Yeah, I think it was stupid of them to mention that number. I think putting the number out there just increases the tension about this sort of thing. I don't see a reason for them to mention that number. I hope it's not that number, but at least it gets the message out there that we're looking for real developers. We're gonna invest some serious time and effort into their games, and we take care and we care about the quality of our games. But yeah, now I think certainly setting expectations as to, hey, I'm a developer, I want to go make a game, here are my ideas, I'm going to go try to make this. And even convincing people that, like, I have this great idea, people, please vote for my game. It sounds kind of silly, but now the way it's going to work is developers are going to have to upload actual games or demos to get people to say, like, I want you to support me and support what I'm doing, and so go buy my demo. If enough people buy my demo, then I'll make another larger demo, and it's silly. But maybe people are just too easily hyped about trailers. My gripe with the whole Steam Greenlight is like, I've used it before. It's been a fun way to go look for products, or potential things that could be interesting. I have a difficult time filtering that. Like, how do I find the things that I'm interested in? I want to support some indie developers or independent developers or whatever you want to call them. Like, I'm not calling Rocket League an independent developer, although some people call it that, but I want to support independent developers who are looking to do creative things. And it's difficult to identify those sorts of people when Steam's focus is on, hey, look, No Man's Sky is 10% off or something. Hey, look, you can get the new Marvel vs. Capcom. And that's like not why I use Steam. I know a lot of people use it that way, but they could use any store for that. I think, yeah, anyway, I'm beating a dead horse. So yeah, I made an effort to try to get this code working. It doesn't work. It's too bad. But can't s nobody say that nobody tried. And we learned a little bit more about how JSON works and how events are sent out and so forth. Even if I didn't really explicitly talk about any of that, at least I have a better understanding of it. So, yay. This is why, like, people suggest things in the forums and say, oh, developer, just code this. You could spend hours coding something and come up with a conclusion that, hey, it doesn't work. And then people in the forums are like, oh, well, you were just doing it wrong. I'm like, great, thanks for the information. But, yeah, this is why some developers are more hesitant to do things than some other developers. And it varies from subject to subject, too. Like, there are a number of things I wouldn't touch with a 10-foot pole. So, to each their own, but this kind of lackadaisical approach that's taken in the forums of, oh, hey, look, developers, just figure something out. Oh, we figured it out. Oh, well, never mind. I don't understand what you're talking about, so go show me in better terms, like, what it is. And, okay, fine. All I'm saying is, like, we figured out, here's how we do it. The hard part is discovering the best way to do it and whether Leak Chess is capable of handling it. What I didn't know at the time was that this particular code that he derived it from is like 700 commits old, so some things in the database have changed. So to even get this to run, I've got to bring it up to the latest version, and now he owes me some code. Yeah, and like maintaining code is non-trivial. It's a fun little goal, but whatever. Yeah, I think there's going to be an ebb and a flow there, and sometimes it'll be better for indies, and some changes will be worse for indie developers. But seeing Greenlight go away says to me, like, I don't know, people were just too easily hyped by trailers, or it was just too unclear how Greenlight was supposed to work, and just I assume Valve just couldn't agree on what to do next with it, so they just killed it. And now they're using Steam Direct instead. But yeah, I don't think, I don't know, I think Greenlight had a lot of promise to it. And I think that other stores will be doing things very similar in the future. Don't know when, but I assume that it's just so taxing to create a demo and then say, if enough people buy my demo, then I'm going to make the full game. And it's even more taxing to make the full game and then find people don't even want it. So I think we're probably going to, for a while again, see more in the way of just like flash games and online games, and until such time that a new market arises and does the same thing that Greenlight used to be doing. That's my opinion. Yeah, I just find it funny the way some of these people talk here. This is a really good notification explaining pros and cons and so forth, and saying, like, you put a lot of effort into coding this, and it's all moot point if there's no interest. And that's not the point I wanted to get across. Like, yeah, we're kind of interested. I mean, this sounds kind of fun. I care. But I can't get your code working, buddy. So, and then another guy's like, hey, look, this sounds fun. Please find a way to get this working. We're like, great. We found a way. The way we found is what he said right here, is just do everything he suggests that works. And he's like, oh, I'm not a developer. I'm not a programmer. I don't understand how to even learn anything. I mean, so, fine. I mean, I figured I'd learn something out of all this. It'd be fun, and I hoped that I could get this working, and I'm just a little disappointed it doesn't work. And I'm a bit hopeful that, within a week, 2 weeks, a month, a year, this developer will get back to me and explain to me how he made it work. But until then, I'm sunk. That's too bad. But what variant is this? This is Flick Chess. I can't show the video because I'm sure it's the YouTube licensed as opposed to Creative Commons licensed. I'm sure almost all these YouTube videos are. Maybe I could find an image. No, maybe I could find rules. forget the rules and just flick your pieces toward opposing lines and try to knock over all your opponent's pieces. So this already exists outside of Lee Chess, which is another reason not to try to integrate it into Lee Chess. It already exists on Android and exists on the web. And here's a developer saying, look what I did. It's apparently already available on iOS. And I'm just surprised he went so far as to actually do it on Lee Chess, but apparently he did. I just unfortunately can't get that implementation working, nor can I find the actual rule set, see, on Wikipedia. Yeah, it's quite the deviation from normal chess, isn't it? So, that was task one I wanted to try to do today. We're 0 for 1, but at least we're done with that for the moment. Maybe people will... I mean, I did post this thing on the Lee Chess Feedback Forum, saying, hey, that's cool. I spent hours merging stuff. Not criticizing you for not starting with the latest change, because you probably did start with the latest code and just struggled with it for quite a while. In light of that, I respected that, and I tried to bring it up to date. But without his help, I'm not going to be able to complete that. Maybe other people could, I don't know. It's probably a bit of work either way. I don't know how much work. I'm certainly taking a break from that. So that's task one I wanted to try to do. Task two was, get this latest Stockfish release. Niklas... Fieldas? I'm drawing a blank. He just recently released a new build. Oh, wow. 3 days ago. I thought this was like February 2nd, but no. November 5th. February 8th. Cool. So he builds this for like Mac OS, for Windows, for Linux, source code, and I mean, he does a really good job packaging all the stuff. And since he's doing the builds, I don't have to worry about buying all those computers and or emulating all those environments and supporting it for all these various platforms. Plus, it gets a second set of eyes on my code, which really is necessary. So, going to download this and download the latest Winboard alpha build. I always forget where this is at. I always have to search it. And here we are. Copy. You know, I bookmarked that if I could, but it's a zip file, and apparently I can't bookmark those. So I guess it's appropriate for me to share my desktop at this point. As long as I don't have anything that shouldn't be shared, that's probably fine. OBS. Share the entire desktop. Here we go. Winboard alpha build. So that's in downloads. So I'm going to take Winboard old, delete that, rename Winboard to Winboard old, go back, take Winboard aa.zip, extract that to the desktop, paste. Okay, it's not going to take a minute. It's just going to be done momentarily. Oh yeah, no, I'm sure it's incompatible and there's no way it would work on Lee Chess on the official site. I'm not even sure how anybody would spectate a game like that, but it's a complete and total mess. But, I mean, he made some effort to try to get it to work, so I'm pushing the limits a little bit and saying that, you know, we'll make an attempt. It's probably not going to be a successful attempt. but it doesn't stop me from trying. Right, paste. Skip identical file names. Okay. Splat window.old. Stockfish. If I run this, Stockfish, December 30th. So there hasn't been a build in the last 3 days for the WinVord alpha build. One way I could try to get a build would be to try to find some bug in the alpha build and then convince Hans-Geert Mueller that this is something worth fixing and putting out a new build for. And by the way, could you include the latest Stockfish? That would be optimistic. It's not going to happen. So instead, I should not be a lazy bum. I should get the Stockfish for Windows. Stockfish MV x86, Stockfish Windows AM. Oh, this is supposed to, wait, MV? I don't understand what Stockfish MV is supposed to mean. So which of these do I do for Windows? It's going to be one ending in exe. So which one of these? Like, do I use BMI2? Do I use modern? Surely it's not the just exe. It's one of the BMI2 or modern. I just don't know if these are going to work. Which is why we download them and find out. So let's show that in the folder. Grab these two, cut, go to my other folder, burn all that, paste, take our BMI2 thing and just rename that to stockfish.exe, that's what I thought he called that at first. And then if I go run the alpha build, not sure if my desktop shortcut's gonna work for that, so I need to go over here. Winboard.exe, yes, run it. Oh, did it fail? No, we got the startup window. Stockfish V, whoops. I wanna use the internet chess server. Specifically, relaychess.org. There we go. In fact, well, let's first see if we get Stockfish working. Then we need to write a launcher script. Stockfish Windows AMD64.exe is not there. Okay, so I could have sworn though that I had to rename one of these to Stockfish. Rename. Let's get rid of dash modern. As opposed to fixing the configuration, which is what I should be doing. But whatever. Alright, so we got a match between two engines now, right? Yeah, it's running. That's the point. Now, next step is to see where's my launcher. I copied over all of my files from the old WinBoard directory to the new WinBoard directory. In theory, this should create, or this should include a batch file that connects me to my server. Type. Okay, that's not, zippy.bat, I think is what I called it. Here it is. TJ chess, oh, right. So I'm gonna call this stockfish.exe. in the directory stockfish. Save that. And what I want to test is, can I run that batch file to connect Stockfish to the ICS? I'm not seeing an ICS window. Oh, there it is. That took a minute, but it's here. Telnet. Oops, I've wanted to telnet to relaychess.org. Port 5000. Oh. Windboard has stopped working. Well, I don't blame it. I can't even telnet to the server. Let's see. Let's go over here. Exit. Switch user to chessd. Not that we need to do that. But we're going to do it anyway. SH relaychess.org. Let's see if that can connect. So switch user to chessd. Okay. So server is apparently up and running. A log is not available. I cannot telnet. So what's the deal? How do I escape a telnet session? How do I escape telnet? Oh, escape character is bracket. Okay. That's what that escape character is means. That's the character to get out of Telnet. Good to know. Control bracket. So how's this? Okay, how's the server doing? ChessD is spinning. That's not good. Shouldn't be taking that many resources. Received signal 15. So these logs go back quite a while. Oh, and then they end. So they're having some reboots, and that's okay. How is it that this background process, which is doing basically nothing, is taking an entire CPU? That's what's got me stumped. Like, there's no reason it should need 100% CPU just to run that. How do I debug what it's doing? I mean, I could kill it and bring it back up and see what it does. Then I might lose the ability to debug it. But at this point, I need to see if I can make any difference in what it's doing. Can I terminate the server? It might not terminate. That's also a mess. And the other thing is, it's not like it's even using 100% memory. Saw that it was using 0.4% memory, so it's not like it's attempting to do anything really memory intensive. My latest changes pertaining to this server were to try to make it work the way that who's the person who's the current maintainer of this server? I'm drawing a blank. It's kind of relevant information here now, isn't it? But he was advising me that I didn't need to make as many aggressive changes as I made, that there was a cleaner, simpler way to make this work. So I believed him, tested it, deployed it, and now it's stuck. Let's go top. Exit. Kill 1352. Oh, it's not running. Top. Well, apparently it's been terminated. Okay, so now things are back to steady state. Yeah, I'm not sure why that was consuming a 100% CPU. I've killed it. I guess it falls to me to now have that not start on boot until I figured out what the heck's going on. So to stop that from starting on boot, locate chsd.service. System CTL disable chsd.service. Okay, and that will prevent it from auto starting. Question: to be or not to be? Let's see. All right, so its status will show us what local changes. None. There aren't any local changes. Get fetch. Right, so I created the segfault branch when I was trying to troubleshoot some things, but I don't need that here. Its status will say that we're already up to date with the latest master. The latest master is Capablanca. Last committed 23 days ago. Updated the copyright header. Printing out the PID file location and so forth. I mean, that was pretty straightforward. I'm sorry, not printing out. This is standardizing the location of where the PID file goes. And then printing out the return code and exiting. So this could run as a background process. Or I'm sorry, it could run as a forking system service, as opposed to just simply a background process. Revert service type, so and I'm attempting to do things without the dash F flag. Dash F requires that it runs in the foreground, which really just means that don't fork. So instead, I change this to fork, and then to print out the process ID into a PID file and user local chsd. It's pretty simple and straightforward to get that going. So as we do status, we find out that indeed this has been stopped and killed. If we do We look at the journal. Journal says that not a whole lot was going on. Just had to kill it forcibly. Let's see. Stop.sh. Yeah, I want to remove that as well. Chessd Mamer. The tournament manager service can also go. So now if I try to stop it, it's stopped. If I try to start it, and then look at its status. Okay, these are capable of running. And if I'm looking at it while it's running, it's not consuming any resources. It's not going to start up automatically on boot anymore, but now as it stands, at least it will run. Yeah, no, that's totally fine. Everybody's busy with all sorts of projects. I've been busy with a ton of things, too. But really, anybody could pick up the code if this became a huge priority. So yeah, I can log in as a guest. And the chessd process is not spiraling out of control. So I'm still not entirely sure what happened there. Okay, so next, don't need the server code there. I've already downloaded Stockfish, but maybe I got the wrong version or something. Who cares? Let's try connecting this and see, is the server going to handle this connection? Hopefully. Oh, I'm tabbing through my browser instead of waiting for the ICS window to pop up. I used to have an automatic logon script for this sort of thing. In fact, Xboard Winboard does support the idea of automatically logging on, but whatever. So, we got one Stockfish connected. That's cool. Yeah, let's run another one. I want to have four of these up and running. Or at least two of them. Come on, my computer can take this. Oops. Okay, we got another window or Winboard instance up and running. One of these days I ought to make a script that automatically connects a user as a guest. All right. So that's two. Now I'm going to do two manually. Actually, why don't I partner these two with each other? Who? Partner guest B. And then over here, we're going to say, where's our, here's our terminal. Who? Partner guest Y. Okay, they've agreed to be partners. Stockfish is now Stockfish's partner. And this is the point of, now there's the new Windows Stockfish build, I can test this. So let's, yep, connect to the ICS, relaychess.org. Here we go. Guest P, and relaychess.org. Yeah, in fact, I don't know. Like, I'm assuming that one of the, I think on the poll it indicated that one of the things Leechess might be considering working on might be chat related, so it might be interesting to see what they end up doing with it. I could be misremembering, but chat is a really hard thing to implement, and I'm not sure what the point is, because they could just use like Discord or really any kind of chat platform out, although I don't know. There's some value into integrating it, but it seems like there's so many ways that people could communicate even outside of the platform. All right, so let's see who's here. Match guest B 30 0 Bughouse unrated. All right, we got some Bughouse guys. E4. Ah, shit. Did I just lose my window? I think I just lost a window. Well, damn. That was the fastest Bughouse game ever. Oh well, let's try that again. So who's left? So guest, I mean, this is the trouble of me trying to do everything myself. But we'll get there. Could even partner Mamer if I wanted to. So yeah, we've got two Stockfishes up and running. Oh, the command here is like Bughoo, right? Bughoo is not found. It's not installed on this server. I need to make that command. How do I add that? So guest ptel hi. Okay, so B and Y are partners. L has no partner. And I need to open another instance. So run connect to relaychess.org. Here we go. And log in as guest. And then partner guest L and partner guest Z. Match guest B 30 0 Bughouse unrated. Okay, this time I get white. Let's see. So, how do I troubleshoot whether this is working or not? So here we're logged in as guest L. This is my guest L console, ptel yo. So I should find yo in one of these consoles. Or I should be looking for guest Z. Just right here. So if Stockfish ever moves, that'll be good. I'm starting to think this is not working so well. I did move E4. My opponent did not move. Games should indicate there are two games. Neither one's clock has started. Okay. Let's see. So how do I get debug info for? I assume it's this window. Engine. Let's see, where's my output window? It's got to be here somewhere, right? Maybe I should have involved TJ Chess in some of this. Just get a TJ Chess versus Stockfish match going. So if I do type games. Again, we've not. For some reason, the clocks haven't started, even though e4 has been played. Is this what's causing the server to panic or something? No, it's working just fine. Server's a-okay. So why do I have a move? None of the clocks are going. None of the engines are moving. Apparently, none of the engines are calculating anything. Should I force one of the engines to move? I don't think that'd be the end of the world. So our game here that we're stuck in is guest L versus guest B. So I need to find the guest B console if I have one. Do I not have one? There's guest L's console, guest Z's, guest Y's. Oh, there's guest B. Okay, clocks have started. Not too concerned about that clock. What's our other game in progress? It's guest Y versus guest Z. So I want to make guest Y play a move. And then guess Z is myself playing a move. And then we're going to go back to the original game, which was me playing as guest L. I'm going to make a move. And by this point, Stockfish should be thinking on some of the boards. So the clocks are ticking. And I'm not sure where to find all the engine output. It's got to be here somewhere. Common settings, polyglot directory, bib, book bin. How do I do Bughouse with engines? It worked for TJ Chess, so I was optimistic this could work. I'm not sure. Obviously, it's not thinking. Though I'm on the wrong window to even check that. This is the window I want to be checking from, but I don't see any engine output anywhere. So, we're in ICS client mode. Oh, here's the engine output window. Indeed. Not a whole lot of output. So I'm not sure where things went wrong. I think what this means is that for me to test whether it can play Bughouse or not, I need to make my own client. That's gonna be fun. I supposed to do with this? How do I just tell the engine go? Engine one settings. No settings to set. Common settings. One CPU. And gosh, let's turn on pondering. Why not? It has no effect. General. Suppose I could turn off pondering. What else could be tried? What is left to be attempted? I could select a different engine, maybe. But this is just editing the list of engines. This isn't. Looks okay. So yeah, I'm stumped. Hint? No hint available. Obviously, no book is available. Move now. Or don't. Yeah. I'm gonna wager that Bughouse was not thought of for this sort of testing. Alright, so let's try something simpler. Abort request sent. Abort request sent. Abort. Hey, we aborted the games. Okay. Let's go back to guest L. Match guest B 330 crazy house unrated. Or is it 30-0 unrated crazy house? Alright. Oh, come on. Evidently, things are very broken. I don't even get a move or rise out of Stockfish this way. So, match guest L30 unrated. Accept the match. Can this get Stockfish to play anything? Nope. It's evidently not moving at all. Could be confused by all that Bughouse we were trying to do earlier. So let's kill all of these. And then go back. Just run Zippy once. And we're just going to connect Stockfish to... Well, am I using the right Stockfish engine? Stockfish.exe. Let me try the other one. So maybe the Stockfish doesn't run. That defeats that theory, doesn't it? Yeah, that Stockfish definitely works. So let's go back here. And while we're at it, what the heck. Let's load Sunsetter. Guest. Cool. And then over here, we're going to be a guest. Okay. Check who's logged in. Match guest J30 unrated. Just a normal game of chess. Okay. You can move any time now, Stockfish. Or you can choose not to move. Here, let me help. E4. It's not your move. I'm in the wrong console. E2, E4. There we go. Sunset are going to move. Illegal move, E4, rejected by first chess program. Okay. That's not what I expected. At least that's a message. Looks like we're stuck here. Rematch. Rematch, command not found. I remember now, I found that that's not a command. Match, guest J30. I guess since everything's being played as a guest, all games are unrated anyway, so I don't need to type unrated each time. So. Could just be that the latest alpha build might have broken stuff. So that says, let's try something that's not an alpha build. Let's try getting the latest stable build of Windboard. Okay, maybe that's not where I wanted to go. I can't even go back. That's great. Windboard. Let's go to this page. To this page. Oh, that is this page. Where do I go to HGM's page? There it is. Okay. Older versions hosted their Windows 4.8 beta. That's more stable than an alpha build. Let's try the beta build. Okay. Copy this exe. I'm honestly unsure if it's an installer or if that's just the executable itself. Sure looks like the executable. So let's cut that, put it into this directory. And now try connecting using our launcher. So we should get a console any second here. There we are, there's a console. And then I could use a separate launcher to get Sunsetter up. Log in as a guest. Match our other guest. So match guest C3O. And man, at some point here I should get a game somehow working. That would be the hope, the dream, the aspiration, the goal, the objective, the thing that's not working. Okay, so we'll abort. Try that with reversed colors. Match guest S3O. Match guest C3O. Give Sunsetter white, just in case there's some kind of stockfish issue. Seriously doubt it. Yeah, no, I'm confused. So, this all worked great in offline play, but as I tried to hook up to the server, something's lost in communication. So I'll just need to be patient until the next stable build comes out, and then test it again. So I was a bit overzealous in testing Stockfish on ICS. For all I know, it could be something server-side that's causing the issue. Although, what in the world could it possibly be, right? So I was intending to go over here, and you see that, like, chess process is not spiraling out of control or anything. So I'm not sure what the issue could be. Could just be that the new adapter is not capable of communicating, I don't know, with the engines when you're doing online play. That might be it. But if that's the case, I'm not sure how to fix it until I just wait for a new adapter to come out. Either way, I'm constrained by interfaces at this point. So we see that neither Stockfish nor Sunsetter is moving in this situation. Okay. Well, I guess that wraps that up. where does that put us for today? We've been going for 3 hours, 50 minutes. Two experiments completed. Two non-successes. But No. If every experiment were a success, would it really be experimenting? So yeah, that's the excitement and joy of coding and doing things completely independently. Is that eventually at some point you do depend upon other people, and there's only so much an individual can do all by themselves, unless they redouble and re-redouble and so forth their efforts and end up building the entire stack. Or unless you end up developing something that's really simple and may or may not be worth doing. Anywhere in between those two extremes, you're going to have some success and some failure. So either you have to do projects which are so simple that they aren't worth doing, or work on some things that are so large scale and to some extent depend upon other softwares, other libraries, other developers, and understand the fact that not every experiment's going to succeed. It's a pity, though, for today, for the knock chess variant, or flick chess variant, where you're kicking your pieces to the opponent's pieces to take them out. So for that, and for this trying to get Stockfish to play Bughouse, I'm 0 for 2. Unfortunately, because of the way the server was running earlier today, I'm even negative 1 for 2 and lost some progress on this server that I thought was working right, and apparently the chess server's not entirely perfectly stable. But yeah, that's the joy of coding. So when people on like LeeChess or other forums say, "Oh, don't you understand how to code? Can't you do this?" That's a different question quite often than, "Is this worth doing?" And today is another example of that distinction. So that's what experimenting's about. I'm sure, given enough time, eventually I'll get the assistance I need from other developers with those particular two experiments I was doing today. But in the meantime, I'll just have to be patient. So, that was fun, right? Yeah, I'm gonna take a break, get some food. So, yeah, thanks for watching, and see you next time.